The bow, a tool of the skirmisher unchanged for millennia. The development of the bow reached its peak form as artillery during the 5th and 4th century BC, right before the invention of the torsion spring. Bow making, in its simplest form, is shaping wood to bend uniformly. Your eyes and judgment is the only measure you need. The bow, in its most basic form, is a bending beam. The belly compresses and the back stretches. Shaping changes the dimensions of the beam, its deflection and the bending of each part. Length. Length of the bow should be as short as possible to achieve a certain draw length. This way there is no energy wasted to move longer limbs. The strength of the bow is inverse to the cube of the length. Thickness. For a given curvature, increasing the thickness will increase the stretch on the back fibers and compression on the belly fibers of the bow. Wood fibers can strain a certain amount before breaking, so the thickness will determine the curve a beam can take before breaking. The strength of the bow is proportional to the cube of the thickness. Cross-section. A strong, lightweight and efficient bow is designed to spread the stress on as many fibers as possible. To spread the load on the width of the bow, the cross-section should be flat. A convex cross-section is easy to work with using hand tools, but results in higher stress of the fibers on the peak of the curves. Width. To avoid the handle hinge and spread the load along the length of the bow, which results in a uniform bend, the limbs have a width taper. The pyramidal is the simplest bow design. A uniform bend can be achieved with a thickness taper, but is much more difficult to achieve because strength depends on the cube of the thickness. Removing very little mass from the thickness will result in heavier limbs. The strength of the bow is proportional to its width. Tillering. Wood is an inconsistent material, so after getting to the general shape, it has to be further tillered in thickness and width to spread the load, avoid hinges, and achieve a good curvature. This can be very tedious work, especially when working with faulty wood pieces. Forced draw curves. The forced draw curve of a bow is the best way to depict bow energy. The area below the curve is the energy stored in a bow. The kinetic energy of the arrow will differ. Scaling dimensions. If we replicate a bow by increasing its dimension by the same percentage, the thickness and length change will cancel each other out. The width change will increase the strength at the same draw length. Now that the bow is longer, the same curvature is achieved at a higher draw length. If the target draw length is the same as before, only width changes make sense. Scaling length and thickness is useful for getting a longer draw length, otherwise it will lead to energy loss in moving the limbs. Materials. Different materials can take more stretch and compression before baking, and thus can be thicker, shorter and stronger, while weaker materials will break at a lower stretch if they are thick, so they are designed to be thinner, longer and wider to achieve the same strength. Because an increase in width increases the strength less than the same increase in thickness, these bows will end up being bulky and heavy, resulting in lower efficiency. This drawback of weaker woods is somewhat balanced by their often lower density. Efficiency by material is taken to the extremes by the composite bow, which uses sinews on the back and horn on the belly. Backing with sinew also changes the shape of the bow, which is the next improvement in bow design. Side profile. Two bows with the same draw weight at 28 inches but different side profiles will have different force draw curves and will store different amounts of energy. Generally, the more curved the bow, the more energy it stores. The change in efficiency is due to the change in leverage the bowstring has on the limbs through the draw length. The high initial pretension of the limbs, which creates an initially steeper increase in draw weight. The ears or sigars is a way to create this better leverage and at the same time increase efficiency by decreasing the mass of the tips. because a stiff part can be slightly thicker and much narrower than a bending part. An interesting deviation from the general bow design is the Japanese yung bow, which is asymmetrical. The energy loss is kept to a minimum by not swinging the whole top arm like in other bows, but recoiling around two nodes, which results in smaller radius and movement of the arms. This way the arms have a lower moment of inertia and less energy is wasted on the recoil of the arms than one would expect. Historical progress. At some point in time, some civilizations invested in the development of bows that would outcast skirmishers and gain an edge over their adversaries. While archers had reached the limits of how far they can pull and how strong they can be, the bow was nowhere near its limits. The ancient engineers would increase either the draw weight or the draw length. In the Far East, the Chinese used the crossbow, which they pulled back with their legs. This resulted in a higher draw weight, but didn't increase the draw length. In Anabasis, Xenophon describes a weird but similar way of pulling back a bow by his Persian enemies. As bowmen, they were most excellent. They had bows nearly 3 cubits long, and their arrows were more than 2 cubits. And when they shot, they would draw their strings by pressing with the left foot against the lower end of the bow, and their arrows would go straight through shields and breastplates. The size of bow and arrow described is common, but the penetration is extraordinary. The loading method is not described well. I believe the Persians would use a type of a crossbow, similarly to the Chinese. That's the only method that wouldn't risk damaging the bow and would make aiming and operating at high draw weights easier. Xenophon referred to it as a bow, but in later times, a similar mix of words happens when onagers are called slings. Mediterranean. At around the same time is the first mention and deployment of bolt-shooting artillery in the Mediterranean. Although the surviving sources don't provide a clear description of the machine, it was probably a developed version of winch-operated gastrophytes or the first torsion engine deployed, which puts the invention of the man-operated gastrophyte at some time earlier. Gastrophytes or belly bow resembles a tiller tree. It was invented in the Mediterranean at an unknown time. We know of its existence only from the text of Ironos Ctesibiu Velopica, describing it as a basis of the catapult design. The bow was initially drawn with a slider mechanism by pushing the stock with the weight or push power of the loaders. It allows for a draw length much longer than a hand-pulled crossbow loaded against the feet, but the draw weight is still limited by the weight and push power of the loaders, which would be around 40 to 80 kg per person depending on the loading method. The loading method. Pushing on slippery ground is ineffective. Pushing against an obstacle at low angles with the feet against another small obstacle gives the best results with pushing. After pushing for most of the power stroke, the last foot of draw length, from 2 meters to 1.7 meters, can be finished by placing the gastrophytes vertically and pulling on the stock. A gastrophytes of this type could be loaded by a two-person crew with a draw weight of 140 kg and draw length of 170 cm. These limitations were later surpassed by the use of the winch. The name gastrophytes persisted and was used for bolt-shooting non-torsion artillery operating with the winch. The slider and trigger system was used later in torsion engines and stayed in use for more than 1,000 years. Beaton's construction of war engines and artillery. Beaton gives the description of 4 bow-operated catapults, 2 of them stone throwers, without mentioning the size of the bows, and 2 arrow-shooting gastrophytes with a description. Once the winch was used for loading scaled-up bows, the general bow shape would probably change disproportionately. The catapults' new designs of bow would have very wide spring parts and thicker but very narrow ears, with the purpose of scaling up without increasing significantly the mass and moment of inertia of the limbs. The largest bow described is for the double bolt gastrophytes designed by Zoprius of Tarentum at Miletus. The bow was 2.77 meters long, or 9 feet. A perimeter of cross-section 28.5 cm. The bolts are 6 feet long, 185 cm, and 3.68 cm in diameter. The mass of each arrow would be around 1.2 kg. The bowstring has a perimeter of 4 dactyls, or 2.45 cm diameter. From this measurement and based on modern information about ropes, we can estimate the breaking load of the bowstring to be 3 to 4 tons. The draw weight of the bow a quarter of that for safety, so 750 to 1000 kilograms. The max draw length is 150 centimeters. Theoretically, this bow can store around 4.7 kilojoules to 5.7 kilojoules. It would shoot at 70% efficiency two balls at 51 meters per second. If the balls were designed correctly, they could reach around 270 meters. The diameter of the bowstring is also given for the modern gastrophytis, which can give us an estimation of capabilities. For the stone thrower catapult, the projectile mass estimation is given by Marsden based on the sling pouch used. I have calculated the capabilities assuming a velocity of 51 meters per second, the same as the double bolt catapult, because anything lower than that would be within the range of skirmishers. This is one of the greatest ancient catapults operating with a bow storing 29 kilojoules of energy. The slider doesn't take any load, so it can be made thinner for bolt shooters, but it needs to be sturdy for stone throwers, and because it is bigger, it is pulled forward with the winch. To achieve this, a rope is attached at the rear end of the slider and runs through a channel below the slider, and then the rope is redirected with pulleys to the winch.